Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Here with me today is Clarice Aiello, Assistant Professor in Quantum Engineer at UCLA. So Clarice, could you tell us what is quantum engineering?
Hello, everybody. Thanks, Lisa, for having me here. So I like to call myself a quantum engineer. This means that I build apparatuses to study and control things that are so small and so well protected from their environment that they're better described by the laws of quantum mechanics, as opposed to the laws of classical mechanics that rule everything around us. The field of quantum engineering, broadly conceived, is concerned with taking quantum systems and trying to steer them somehow in order for them to do something useful for us. For example, two subfields, I would say, of quantum engineering might be quantum computing, which is hyped right now, which is super cool, which means that we're using quantum objects as fundamental units of computation. And we can prove that if you build a computer out of quantum objects, the power that you get from that computation far surpasses the computations that your desktop right now, your classical desktop, can perform. Another theme of quantum engineering is the field of quantum sensing. And it can be proved by mathematical means that if you use a quantum object as a sensor, your measurement is improved. In other words, the sensor quantumness enhances the measurement. So in my past, I have worked with technological quantum sensors that worked at room temperature and under messy environmental conditions, say within a solid or say in close proximity to a biological sample. So this is the field of my training.
So can you tell us a little bit about what you've learned about biology at the nanoscale using these quantum sensors?
Yes, and there are two parts to my answer. First of all, you can directly use those technological quantum sensors onto biological samples to learn things about the biological sample. You can, say, insert a quantum sensor inside, say, a cell and very precisely monitor how cellular parameters are evolving, such as like local magnetic fields or temperature changes. This is one way that quantum sensing can be applied to biology. There's another take, though, on how quantum sensors can be used to learn about biology. So there's incomplete but enough evidence that suggests that organisms are, for a short time, behaving as living quantum sensors. So, for example, spin. Spin is a purely quantum mechanical property that electrons and some atomic nuclei have. And this spin quantum property measures how well that quantum object interacts with magnetic fields. And one can use spins in, say, inorganic materials as quantum sensors. Okay, we can put spins in materials to sense things such as magnetic fields, electric fields, and temperature, among others. It turns out that spins in electrons, in proteins inside biological samples, might be acting as living quantum sensors for a short time, in that they are mediating the interaction of the biological specimen with, for example, electromagnetic fields. In this sense, if that's true, this means that those spins inside biological materials are behaving as living quantum sensors. And if that's so, there's a lot of opportunities for us to take a lot of the techniques that were developed to study and control technological quantum sensors and apply onto those living quantum sensors, onto those spins in biological materials, and treat those, try to control and study them as if they were, because they are, bona fide quantum sensors. So what we are trying to learn about biology is via those spins inside biological samples. What we want to learn is to what extent nature relies on harnessing quantum mechanical laws in order to function. And we also want to learn, as a long-term goal, how to control those already existing endogenous quantum knobs inside biological specimen to, say, therapeutic and a technological advantage. That is, can we drive physiology by controlling spin degrees of freedom in biological materials. So this is what we do in our laboratory at UCLA.
So just to probe that a little bit further, when you talk about the possibility of a biological quantum sensor that may use the spin phenomena in proteins and cells, is this related in any way to how animals or birds navigate?
Yes, you might have heard about birds and the navigation, right? So in fact, a lot of this thinking about spins in biology started when, in the end of the 1970s, theoretical biophysicists proposed that maybe a spin-mediated phenomena was sort of behind the way that complex organisms such as birds and butterflies followed the magnetic field of the Earth to navigate. So in brief, it's known from chemistry that magnetic fields can alter the final products of a class of chemical reactions that depend on spin. For those of you who remember your classes, a spin is usually represented by chemists and physicists with an arrow, and arrow up or arrow down signify two different energy levels of this quantum property called spin. It's well understood that in vials, right, when you're talking about chemical reactions, there are reactions that proceed through one branch if a certain spin is up, and they proceed through another branch if a certain spin is down. Importantly, downstream, right, the products of those two different spin-dependent branches are macroscopically different. So a finicky spin-flip phenomena occurring at the very top of a chemical reaction might have macroscopic chemical consequences at much, much longer timescales. So in the end of the 1970s, biophysicists proposed, well, were the same type of spin-dependent chemical reaction present in organisms, organisms could sense the magnetic field of the Earth to the extent that they could sense different physiological concentrations of products coming from such spin-dependent chemical reactions. Right now, avian navigation became one of the poster children for potential spin effects that regulate physiological functioning. But it's not only this. It's not super widespread. What I'm going to talk about now is still a subject of active research. There's evidence that the same type of spin-mediated chemical reactions are also at play in the regulation of many, many important physiological phenomena, such as the production of reactive oxygen species, the growth of embryos, crop and stem cells, regulation of inflammation, regulation of DNA repair. And I think that there's a lot to be explored in this space. And of course, we're taking a very nanotechnological approach to biological samples, right? What we want to do is understand how spin phenomena might play a role in biology in a very high-tech way. And we think that this is going to have a lot of maybe even technological implications, right? That we could drive spin phenomena with the help of weak external magnetic fields in a non-invasive way and try to predictably steer physiological reactions that depend on spin.
So that's really interesting. Is there an opportunity to maybe do the reverse of a spin sensor and drive spin behavior to control things like inflammation and the other biological behaviors that you mentioned?
In principle, yes. Now, this is very far from being a reality. I think there's a lot of phase space to discover things that may lead to therapeutics. And I think that the current bottleneck in this field is really instrumentation that harness nanotechnological, if you want, degrees of freedom in biological specimen, right? And this is one of the gaps that we're trying to address in our lab. We are trying to develop those super high-tech instruments that look at those spins in biology as if they were technological quantum sensors, right? In a way to predictably and systematically understand how those spins interact with their environment. And to your point, yes, I think that it's a little bit of a reverse process now, right? It's like influencing the spins because the spins are sensitive to magnetic fields. So yes, I do think that in, say, 50 years, we might have technological applications that regulate spin physics in biological systems. And if I may, I may commit a heresy here and compare this field to the field of quantum computing, of where it was, say, 25 years ago. The field of quantum computing 25 years ago was incipient, right? There was a lot of theory that was proposed on how a quantum computer could work. Then slowly, there were some brave experimental groups across the world that started trying to realize quantum gates with objects, with atoms and with ions. And after a couple of those early realizations of quantum bits and quantum computers, there has been an explosion of groups interested in quantum computing. And now there's even more, right? Now there's a flourishing quantum industry. And again, 25 years ago, there weren't any experiments on that. And I think we might be at the same frontier with the field that is usually referred to as quantum biology. Well-controlled, systematic experiments are starting to come true. And I think that if the trend continues, we're going to have a lot of quantum knobs to play with in biological systems in a systematic way.
How exciting to be really at the emerging stages of this interesting area of research. How do you envision the impact of your work in the future?
I think that the impact of my work might come from two fronts. One is from the research point of view. Again, I think that within decades, we will be able to rationally control endogenous quantum knobs to therapeutic and technological advantage. Another thing that I didn't mention was the fact that if nature really is using somehow existing quantum knobs in order to function, I would like to understand if we can learn with nature to build better technology. Because if nature is using those quantum mechanical knobs, it means that it understands very well, especially how to deal with noise, right? And noise, or type of loss that decreases the quantum character of an object, is what prevents quantum computers to be widely used nowadays. So I'm not saying let's replace the wonderful quantum computer at Google with molecules, but can we understand some strategy at play in nature and apply the same strategy on top of the quantum computing architecture that people are developing nowadays? So this is one part where our work might impact nanotechnology and impact things in the future. So building better technologies and maybe driving physiology. The other aspect of my work that I think might play a role, and I think this is personally important to me, is trying to figure out how we're going to train the next generation of scientists, especially those who are interested in interdisciplinary research. Our team is very interdisciplinary. We have chemists, we have biologists, we have physicists, we have engineers, and we're all the time talking to each other and learning with each other. So I hope that our work help frame the discussion on how to broadly train students who are interested in more interdisciplinary research. How can we contemplate many different visions on a problem, right? And how our academic institutions might need to transform to be able to adapt to the reality of interdisciplinary research. And again, I think I mentioned before that I firmly believe that interdisciplinarity is what is going to give us power to solve the big scientific challenges in this coming century. Specifically on how, for example, nanotechnology interfaces with biology. I think interfacing biothings and physicky things is going to be important across many different disciplines, and I hope we will help frame the discussion very, very soon on that topic.
Clarice, I just want to thank you again for taking the time to talk with us today. Do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with the listeners?
I think there's a huge value in talking to people with complementary expertise, and that serendipitously we learn things when we're least expecting. So if you're an engineer go take a literature course. If you're an MD, go learn electronics. And I think that there's a lot of opportunities for serendipitous findings. And I hope you have fun talking to people with all sorts of backgrounds.